The TrekWorks YouTube channel is sponsored by Tenet Controls. And by HDA Model Works, suppliers of scale model lighting products, detail parts, and complete model kits. Visit hdamodelworks.com today. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to part three of our 1/350 scale Polar Lights Klingon Katinga build. Made a lot of progress since our last video, everyone. Got the whole forward section here finished up. Finished all my paintwork on that and put on all the little detail parts. So we thought we'd show you how that's turning out. There are a couple of small little light leaks that pop on here and there, and I wanted to leave those alone and show you what you can expect on your build when you build it and where they're located and... you know, you'll see that they're going to all be really, really easy to fix because, like I said, this model is actually designed to be lit, so they keep the light leaks at a minimum. But a little bit more paint detail on the forward part here since you last saw it. I've added a couple more colors, namely this kind of darker green color that you see here and around this upper part. Notice that when I went back and looked at some more pictures of the studio model and watched a couple clips from the film again. And some of these lighter colored tiny little panels on the forward edge here in different color brown and tans that I did see on the model. So we got that all cleaned up. Went ahead and started going, you know, working my way back on the neck, and I've got all that paint work done there. And all the way back to the that bulkhead where the neck connects to the main hull of the ship. All that's been painted. Now, I want to mention again that this has all been painted with a brush, guys. This is all using craft acrylic paints. I didn't use any masks so far. The only airbrushing I've done on this is the overall green color, but you know, all these different colors on here, including this long strip of black, which they call NATO black. It's sort of a grayish black, and then all these colors down here on this forward part are all painted on by hand, and I'm really pleased with how that stuff looks. I'll kind of give you a shot down below here. Maybe you can see it a little bit more clear. And so we did that. We did all the detail here on the bottom of the neck as well, and the different colors going on there. Now there's still a whole bunch of little detail parts that go on here that are painted different colors too. There's some, you know, intricate, these little kind of paddle looking things, and there's like a little antenna thing that goes on here. Some of those are painted yellow and some other kind of neat colors that'll really grab your eye. A couple little red things on there, and that'll add even more detail to that. If it's not detailed enough already, I really think that looks slick. They did an outstanding job on the you know, including as much as they could that they could make out of plastic parts on this kit without going to straight photo, which I think they did an outstanding job on this. So you can see I've got my warp nacelles on here too. They're just mocked on there right now. They're not even tilted at the right angle yet because they're just taped in place. But I'm going to light this up in a second and show you all that. Like I said, all of our internal components that we used on this forward part here worked out just fine. The ones that I talked about in part two where we used our LED tape right up here at the front. We used two more strips in the bottom to light the lower half and a single red LED up here to light the bridge. Or there were a couple of more LEDs that needed to go in this, and these are the ones that are right here that there's one on each side and they face towards the rear. And those are supposed to be like really super bright. Those are like floodlights that shine on the rear part of the ship and light the whole this kind of forward part up here and kind of cast over the top a little bit. You've got the same effect that needs to go on the tops of the wings, you know, that extends away from the impulse deck. And then there are two more like that on the very bottom that point towards the rear. So looking at what the kit gave you, they gave you these little bitty clear plastic lenses that go in there, and you put the, they recommended putting a 3mm LED, you know, inside here, and it hit that and then that came back. Well, all that did was just put out a little bit of light. I mean, it didn't cast the light backward like it's supposed to at all, like a floodlight effect. It just, you know, showed you that there were, that the light was there. So I modified that. What I did here is I used one of these. This is called a lighthouse LED, and these are known for being super bright. As you can see, it's got that little extended tip on there, which concentrates the light into a focused point. And this one's been modified a little bit. You can see on the edges of it, I grinded it down. I grinded it down as thin as I could with my Dremel tool before I ran into the filament on the inside, which you can see because it's done in clear, and laid that on its side, and that wound up fitting in here exactly right in that little slot that the LED, the 3mm, is supposed to fit in. And I was able to extend that tip out just a little bit to where, if you look in here really close, this little kind of V-shaped part right back here has a little notch in it, and you want to make sure that that tip just barely extends past that a little bit so that that notch is not partially blocking that light that comes out of there. And then the kit supplied part, which is that little clear lens that go in there, it has an part of it sticks out on the outside, so it's supposed to have a little bit of detail right there. So what I wound up doing is I just clipped off the part that's on the inside of the model that the LED was supposed to hit, and I glued that on, you know, threw that away, and I used the outside part and glued that onto the side of my you know, my tip right here that's coming out. And it looks amazingly almost exactly like the original part, but now we have a real emitter right here that's on the outside of the model, and it just puts out a tremendous amount of light, and it gives that realistic floodlight look like we were looking for. So I'll go ahead and power the model on now for you, and just once more to show you that we've got here's how those windows, many of you guys asked me to show a clearer shot of this, so here's how these windows look without the photo etch parts in normal room lighting. This is a fully lit shop with, I've got 8-foot fluorescent lights up on the ceiling in here. And you can see that. I think you can see these windows just fine. I don't see any reason to make these any brighter. They're plenty bright. As we walk around the model, you can see they all show up. I'm talking about the lower row now. People were concerned that they, you know, that they don't show up enough, and I haven't modified those at all. Now, they are really small, so what you have to pay attention to when you're putting this model together, and that's something I forgot to mention in my last video, is that every time I put a coat of primer on this thing, or paint, I took a small little sewing needle and I went in there and I just kind of rubbed it around in each hole and re-cleared out each hole, because they're so small that even the primer and the paint can start to pile up in there and actually block them and make them even smaller than they already are. So just take that one extra step and you should be just fine. Again, if you want to go ahead and use the photo etch, more power to you, but you have to realize that you're going to wind up with a weird looking lip going all around here where you're going to see the upper and lower edge of it. If you wanted to take the time to putty all that in and all that stuff, that's totally up to you, but that's a heck of a lot of work. And that, and again, when you're putting putty on top of everything, you're going to lose a whole bunch of this detail and everything. So I think going just right out of the box is the way to go, guys. Like I said, you just have to be smart about where you position your lights and everything, and you can get this to work just fine. Again, there's our top section looking really good. Now I'm going to take the camera over here on the side and put it down below, and hopefully you can see that right up in here is where you're going to have a couple of light leaks, this little louvered looking piece that goes on here. There's a tiny little gap in between each little point right there. You can see light coming out of that, but it's so tiny that I actually already did touch one of them up. I just took my paintbrush and with a little, you know, tiny drop of paint on it, I just touched it on there and it immediately went away. That's how small of a gap it is. Light leaks always, you know, seem to be a lot bigger than what they really are, because just, you know, especially when you look at it with a camera, because it just picks that up. And so you can see they're going to be really easy to fix. There were one or two really little tiny ones right here on the corner where this faceplate meets on there. And I did that same thing to touch them up. And you can't even see where I touched it up with my paint or anything. So you don't have to worry about ruining your paint job just by doing a little bit of touch-up here. Just be really careful. So you got the same thing over here on this side. It doesn't show up as much on this side because there's some more light hitting it, but it's there if I look at it in low light. But those are going to be really easy fixes. Down here where the neck meets, where the little pins come in at the bottom, there's a tiny little leak right down there. You really can't see it from here, but it's there. And just, like I said, really small stuff like that, and, you know, nothing major at all. It's really easy to fix. So, again, I think they did a really nice job on the engineering. So, talking about those little lighthouse LEDs again, let me spin the model here a little bit. And I'll get you right down on here, and you can see those little round floodlights coming back from underneath of the bridge there, and how they light up all the way along that neck, and they're super intense looking and very bright and nice and round like they should be, just like they were in the movie. Now in low light, it totally floods this whole neck with light, and it lights up this this whole forward area right here, which really looks cool. It puts, you know, like kind of shadows on it and makes it look really even more detailed. So that's a nice little thing. So you might want to think about using these. These are all available. All the components I'm using for this, for lighting, are all available, like I said, at HDA Model Works. And they all run off the same kind of resistor. I'm just using a standard, 470 ohm, 1/4 watt resistor. And I'm running this thing at, I'm going to actually run this model at 12 volts. I just kind of looking at everything, the overall lighting and all, I usually run everything at 9, but just overall balancing everything out, I think it's going to look better at 12, so that's what I'm decided to do. So here you can see the Tenet Controls control board, and it's got several outputs on it. I've just gone ahead now and hooked up the these marker beacon lights here. You got one at the neck, and you got one down here on the belly that you can see. Now, if you look closely at that, they are slowly ramping up and down like they're supposed to do in the movie. Ralph captured that detail really well. When I remembered watching the movie, I thought they just blinked. But sure enough, when I went back and watched the clip of the film of the ships coming towards you, they're doing exactly like that. You know, they're just kind of slowly ramping up and down. So he's got that going on. And then, of course, we have the torpedo firing effects. I'm going to move the camera over here to the front. And I don't have the sound hooked up on this yet, but I do have the lighting installed. Now, to build the photon torpedo launcher, you use the Paragrafix photo etch discs that come with that, and those discs replace the plastic lenses that are included in the kit, so you get a much more kind of a focused looking lighting coming out of the front of it. And so you'll see that there's 8 holes in the discs for the perimeter and 1 in the center. So Ralph had you set it up with 8 3mm amber LEDs for the outer ring, and then he was going to use another amber LED for the center. Well, I wanted to have my torpedo fire in red, so I substituted a 5mm red for the center one, and I wanted the center one to be, you know, a little bit brighter than the amber ones too when it fired, so I used a bigger LED. And they all glue, you know, you just glue the tip of them right down on that disc over the hole in it. They all line up really good. You just kind of build a little circle, keeping either the positive or the negative of the wires coming off the LEDs. You know, one of them, just pick which one. Have it facing towards the outside, and when you're done, you just take a little piece of wire and make a ring all the way around the connectors and solder them all in a chain. Then you do the same thing on the, you know, if you start off with the negative, you do the same thing on the positive. And then you just run power wires directly to that, you know, a plus and a minus. For a plus and a minus goes to the ring of 8, and then a plus and a minus goes to the center one in red. No resistors required. The board is pre-resistored and it controls all that. So I don't have my momentary switch hooked up, but I've got the trigger wire here. It might get a little bumpy a second. All I've got to do is touch this trigger wire here on the ground, and it'll activate the torpedo. Takes a couple times to get that going. Let me make sure I'm touching it in the right spot here. There we go. And I'll just try to give you a kind of steady camera shot. And you can see you get a beautiful effect in there with a really focused light. You can see those 8 individual bulbs are really clearly defined. And then that red one in the center. And each time you press the momentary switch once, it will fire three bursts out the front and then fade off like that. I'll hit it for you one more time. And there we go. Beautiful effect. I think Ralph did a great job on that. And like I said, using the photo etch part makes a big difference. It's not as hard as it seems to build. It just took a little bit of time. It wasn't that tedious at all. And then here we have the nice slow ramp down. Love how that fades out and disappears like that. So that's really cool. And I'll be repeating the exact same procedure for the rearward launching torpedo. It has another one of those discs, slightly bigger in diameter, but it's the same procedure. So yeah, everything is working out really good on this, guys. I'm really happy. Here's my base I'm working on so far. This is it's the original Polar Lights base that comes with a kit, but I had this leftover Klingon base from an old Klingon kit. I don't even remember which one it was. It might have been the old AMT Earl Vorcha kit, if I'm not mistaken, but I thought that would look really cool because it's a semi-dome itself, and you drop it down on there, and it sits perfectly on top of that base like it was made for it. I'm going to do a little bit more fancy painting on it, but that's just kind of my basic concept of what I'm going to do. Now I'll show you the engine nacelles. I've got those mocked up and sitting on here. The colors that they used on this are really interesting. Here at the rear, I was looking at the studio model pictures, and they use like a really cool-looking iridescent bluish-purple on these areas right here on the back. And so I found some paint that came really close to that. Again, that's more of this craft acrylic paints. I bought this at Walmart. It's called Color Shift Blue. And it does that, if I can show you the lid there, it does that same effect in person here. Now, these cameras never really pick this effect up at all in person or, you know, on camera. But in person, it looks beautiful. And I'm really happy with the choice that I made there. It comes really close to looking the way that the studio model did. I don't know if I can kind of maybe pan around on it here and you'll see the color shifting a little bit. It might show up better in a little bit lower lighting too, but it looks really sharp. And then I painted in the details on the grills here. All they did there is they used like a NATO black, and then they had dusted over it a little bit with a little bit of green, the same color hull green. You could tell they went over it with a little airbrush and just kind of dusted on the highlights a little bit. There's a lot more painting detail that needs to be done on these. There's all kinds of you know, some more of these brown and tan colors that go on there, this kind of fading, almost like racing stripes that, you know, fade out and go towards the rear. So we'll get all that painted on. But here's the standard lighting that you see on the model kit with these lights here on the outboard, and you can see them over on the other side, the inboard, and then you've got the little tail light there. But if you look at the film, there's one shot in the film where they show this super up-close shot of the engine nacelle. And just so everybody knows, that was a separate model that was made in giant scale of just the nacelle itself. It wasn't actually on the studio model. It was a huge model that they made so they could super detail it with all kinds of little greelies all over it and, you know, really neat looking stuff. And when you look at that shot, you'll see that there's these extra lights that were kind of right in this area right here and a little one up here on this spot right here. I don't have a fiber optic in there yet, otherwise you'd see that lit. I do have one on the other side. Maybe I can show you that one. But they were not very bright. They were, you know, they were just kind of there. They weren't as bright as these guys right here on the side. And I don't know why I'm having trouble focusing all of a sudden, but yeah, these guys here were a little bit brighter than the rest of it, so I try to kind of do that. That's some 0.25 fiber optic in there to light those up. So, and then this one's got the tail light on it as well, if I get around here. Now, on the inside of the nacelles, to light them, right about here on the inside, I have a little three-bulb strip of regular LED tape, and it's laying on its side, so it's glued standing up on its side, facing towards the rear. And that lights up these two here and the taillights that you can see there. And they have this really ingenious little kind of plastic piece that starts off right here, and it's got like a little tube that runs back, and it, you know, it carries the light all the way through that, and that works really, really good. Up here, the window lighting, the same thing as I did on the forward part of the bridge there, or the front end. You can see I've got these, you have these clear little lenses that go in there, and I painted the back of them white, like I did before, And then I've got three little bulbs of regular white LED on a little short piece of strip glued standing up, you know, facing straight down. So it's not going to be blasting light straight at this thing. It's just kind of casting light over it. And then with that white paint on there, you don't get any hot spots. And we'll just show you this again one more time, a little closer. And you can see with that white paint that you get the nice lighting that you want, but as I'm moving it, you notice that there's none of those twinkling effects going on that you see on a lot of models where they didn't diffuse the lighting enough, and it just makes a really big difference. And plus, it makes the lighting kind of come to the surface a little bit better, I think. It just makes it more pronounced and looks really good. So on the tenant controls board here, there's several outputs. All the lighting is included in this kit, so you've got all your static lighting that can be run off the board too. So I'm designing my own lighting system for this, so I didn't use all that. So some of the outputs are not going to be used. Like I mentioned, I'm only going to use the output here for these strobes and the nav lights, and then there's a flickering engine effect, kind of a pulsing engine effect that comes off the board that I will be using. So other than that, I'm using all my own, just running direct power to my own lighting, which is what I usually do on a lot of my builds. I don't know why my camera's acting funky with the focus, but so there you go, guys. There's a look at all that. I'm going to be going next and getting the top part of the wings, getting ready to put that on. One of the things that I noticed about this kit was that when I went to test fit the wings onto the top, it didn't want to go down on there, and in fact, it didn't want to go down there very good at all. Two of the little pins were already broken off when I took it out of the bag. But the problem was is that these pinholes here, the female side, was not opened up anywhere near enough. You can look at it and visually see it when you look at your kit. You'll see that the pins are fairly thick, and these holes were like really, really tiny. So a quick fix for that, just take your hobby knife, a number 11 blade, stick it straight down in there and just start spinning it, and you'll kind of bevel it out and open them up. And then once you do that, I went back and tried it again, and the lid just popped right down on there like with no problem. So I'll be working on the upper part of this model next. Again, using more of these lighthouse LEDs for the floodlighting on the top of the wings, and then the two that run towards the start out right here and face towards the rear and flood the rear, you know, the bottom part of the wings. And I'm really happy with those. Those are going to work out great because you can. I noticed when I was playing around with them too, like especially up here on the top, I had the little top piece mocked up. And just by sliding it in or out a little bit, I could completely change the focus of how wide the V was that that the light puts out. You know, you want a nice kind of a V-looking pattern, kind of spreading out kind of wide. And so it lights up almost at that whole top of that wing on each side. So we'll show you all that when we get to it. Right now, for the conclusion of this video, I've been working on the Paragrafix shuttle bay kit for this and figuring out how to assemble it and put all my lighting in it and everything like that. So let's take you back to the bench here in just a second, and we'll show you all the work we've been doing with that and explain how we figured everything out. So I'll be right back with that. Hey everybody, back with you for more. Well, here we are working on the shuttle bay. A lot of you are writing to me very interested in the Paragrafix aftermarket kit for this model, which is the shuttle bay detail. I'm really saying that this is really a beautiful little add-on for your model and well worth getting for your kit. It's really not that expensive, and after I started working on it and putting it together, you can just see all the potential it has to really take your model to a whole new level of detail. And it's super easy to work with. It's engineered to fit perfectly with the kit. So let's start talking about what we had to do to make it. I didn't bother shooting any material of actually working with the photo etch itself because it's really super straightforward, guys. I'm just going to explain it real quick. The interior shuttle bay detail here starts off with a flat sheet of photo etch that's got three sides on it that are meant to be bent, and you basically just bend those straight up. They join together here. There's little tabs in each corner. You can see when they fit into place that they're locked into place properly. And once you get it to that general position, the way you usually do with photo etch, you glue it together. I used a little bit of CA glue and just made a little dab there on each corner and used a little bit of kicker to set it in place really quick just to kind of test fit it and everything before I went ahead and glued it all permanently. And started off with that first step. Then you have to come and you have to actually modify the kit supplied part, which this is a plastic part that comes with the model kit itself, this rear bulkhead here. And the kit comes with the shuttle bay doors closed, or you know, molded in the closed position. So we have to get rid of those. And they recommend taking a hobby knife and scribing your way through there. Well, to speed that process up a little bit, I took my Dremel tool and went back on the backside here and just carefully grinded on the very edges all the way around those corners. And I made sure I didn't go all the way through, but I just wanted to make the plastic a little bit thinner so I could have it easier with my hobby knife here. And sure enough, it worked. I just had to go a couple of scribes across each way, and the piece just popped right out of there. It's really important, and they talk about it in the instructions for the photo etch here, that you keep these edges nice and clean so that these little extensions that extend back into the shuttle bay, you're cutting right along that little line right there where the door originally was. That way when you put the shuttle bay in here and you look around the edges of it, you've got a nice clean look, you know, no jagged edges or anything like that. Plus, the extensions are supposed to remain there a little bit because on the back side here, that's how the shuttle bay attaches to the actual floor and the walls here attach to that part. The floor of the shuttle bay itself slides over the top of this piece here so that that ledge comes right out to the very end. That's important because that makes everything line up here, and so you don't have a little drop off in there or a gap. It all looks flush. And then on the sides here, when you're bending these walls, you want to make sure that they come up and they just touch against these little raised edges that you can see in here. And then once you know, kind of feel that out, you just kind of tack glue it in place, and that's what I did here. Used regular CA to glue it right onto the plastic. Then I went all the way around the bottom here, where the little floor meets the outer part here, and put a bead of CA glue all the way across that so that that'll be sealed. Now, I haven't back painted that yet, but I will back paint that with some black all the way around these edges here, and that'll make sure I don't have any light leaks. I already tested this and I saw I had a little tiny one right there where the light's trying to come through underneath of that floor. So once I back paint that's all gone. So that's the basic first step of putting this together. I've also went ahead and applied the decal set for this from HDA Model Works. You buy these separately, and they're made to fit the photo etch set. And this is just absolutely beautiful. If I can get this up to you without the glare on it, guys, you can see Jerry does fantastic artwork on his decals. And you've got the Klingon logo here with a really nice little kind of ring around it. You've got all this detail on these walls and everything. Don't mind the missing decal here. Dummy me, I lost that one. I think I dropped it on the floor or something when I was working with it, and I looked high and low, and unfortunately it went into the black hole we know that exists around all of our modeling benches. It'll probably turn up here in, you know, a couple of months, but Jerry's already sending me out a new set, and he'll do that for anybody out there, I'm sure. But so we'll have that here pretty shortly. But here's the other ones, and you can see you've got the rear wall there, and you've got the side wall, and that floor is just beautiful. He's even got some weathering on here to make it look kind of scuffed up and all that. So that looks gorgeous. Now, the film that he made this out of is much thicker than regular decal film. I'm not sure if he did that on purpose or not, but it works really well because, as you guys know, when you're trying to backlight decals, they're so thin and the ink on them is so fine that they usually just wind up getting completely washed out when you put an LED light. Even if you diffuse it, they just don't look quite right. They look like a TV that the contrast is turned up way too high. But since these are thicker and the ink is stronger on them, they're kind of meant to be backlit. And so what I did here is, on the photo etch parts itself, there is this really intricate pattern of tiny little holes that are all the way around that Klingon logo. And I thought, hey, that's just meant to be lit. That has to be lit up. So I just took some Tamiya transparent green and went around the outer ring, and some transparent red and went around the center of it. You don't have to be pretty on that at all because you're just basically trying to get the color in there. And took a little test LED and put it behind it and looked at it, and it looked fabulous. So I decided to go with that inside of our build here, just to add some extra oomph inside that shuttle bay. Now, these little specks of white you see on here were leftover pieces of white styrene because I glued a piece of clear styrene on here that you can see. But I thought it was going to need to be diffused because the light that's going to hit this is pretty close, you know, from the bottom side. But it turned out when I put the white on there, it didn't need it. It was too thick, even though it was a really super thin piece of styrene, and it toned it down too much. So I went ahead and got rid of that, and you can see how good it sticks on here with CA glue. I couldn't actually even get these little pieces back off of here, and I didn't want to force it because it's kind of fragile. But you never even see any of this anyway, so I'm not worried about it. So we have that done. Again, just glued this little lens on down here, so we would have, you know, not direct light coming straight through the decal, but so I've got the idea of lighting that on the bottom. Well, then we've got to have overhead lights inside the shuttle bay too. So here is the photo etch part you can see, which is the ceiling, and I'll show you this side first because you can see it has all this nice grid work that was cut into it in the center and along the edges here. And then of course Jerry's beautiful decal that overlays all that and gives you all that beautiful, you know, you could never paint that on there that clean and with that much detail. And the nice thing about Jerry's decals is that, as you can see, all the girders and everything and the detail on here lines up with the raised details of the photo etch perfectly. So it looks like it's painted on, and it's absolutely gorgeous. I haven't hit this with any dulling agent yet either. It's just straight up the decal on there. And it's absolutely gorgeous. And you can see, put my hand behind it, you can see through it. So I knew that needed to be lit. Now this kind of sits down here on top of the photo etch part. Again, there's a couple little notches on there. So you can see when you've assembled it correctly, it just fits together just perfectly. And you're going to need very minimal amount of glue. Now I will point out that when you make these bends on the lower part here, let me show you this again. Normally photo etch is, you know, solid all the way across, and they have these scribe lines in it. So when you bend it, it'll bend easier. Well, I thought that's how this was. I didn't notice it until I put light to it, but there are tiny little slits that are cut in the photo etch part here on these corners. So they're solid in the center and solid on the end, but there are little gaps. So when you fold it and you know, put it all together, you won't really see it. But when you shine light in there, you'll see the little light leaks. But we'll fix that really easy. We'll just come around the outside edges here with a little bead of glue. Or you can use tulip. Whoops, grab my wires there. You can use tulip or whatever you want to use, and just light block that, and that'll make that whole problem go away. You won't have to worry about that. Just a minor little thing. We'll probably wind up doing the same thing where the roof sits on the top of this. So, okay, so you've got the photo etch built and all that, and you got the rear bulkhead attached. So what happens next? You want to know about what, you know, you need to do to modify on the model itself to get this to fit in there. So we'll go ahead and talk about that. I've got the top part of the wings here, and I've started building up the little impulse deck, which is the forward little glowing red area here, and the shuttle bay is located here at the back. So I mocked up all these pieces, and I started trying to, you know, see how everything was going to work. Well, as it shows in the instruction sheet for the shuttle bay photo etch, this thing is really funky how it sits on here. We'll come back to that. Let me get it lined up here if I can. As it says on the photo etch instruction sheet, this bottom piece needs to be opened up. So starting off with here, you can see that this whole thing was all one solid piece of plastic. You have this lower part here and then this kind of dome or cap piece that goes on the top of it. And so this part here, the lower part, had to be opened up to accommodate the shuttle bay. Otherwise, this is all solid and it won't slide in there. That was never meant to be opened up like that. So the instructions tell you to cut this out. So what I did is I carefully laid it up in here. Let me get rid of this roof so I don't drop it. Turn it over. And took a marker and I marked, you know, to the outer edges of where this was going to go. Now the side to side, you know, you can see you get almost over to the edge there. And it's a pretty tight fit. And especially close, I want to mention to you guys to be careful if you do this. Right up here, this forward one, you can see that once you get this put in here properly where the rear bulkhead fits like it's supposed to up against the top and the shuttle bay is attached to it, it leaves very, very little room here at the forward part for this to fit. Okay, so you don't want to cut, I mean, you want to keep this, you want to make sure you have enough room, of course, but you don't want to go too far forward here with your cut, because if you do, what's going to happen is you're going to go beyond the area that this cap covers up, and you're going to have a big old gap right here that you're going to have to go back and fix. So don't make that mistake. Always measure twice and cut once, guys. It's an old carpenter saying, but you know, when I was looking at it, I was making my marks and I would turn it over to look and see, and then put this part on there and go, okay, yeah, that's going to be really close. So just be really careful with that. So you get that all cut open, and then you're ready to put the shuttle bay in there. So then we had to start thinking about lighting, and I wanted to figure out how I could get lights in there. Well, when I test fit this in here with the roof on it, I could see right away that it was practically already touching this top part here. There's like no clearance in there, right? So my original plan of using regular LED tape up in here wasn't going to work, because even that LED tape, as low as it is, it was already too tall, and it was going to make the roof of the it was going to, you know, hit the roof of the shuttle bay and make it bow down slightly, and I just didn't want that. So I have this other LED tape here. This is 0805, the really tiny miniature stuff, and again, you can get this from Jerry at HD Model Works, and you can see it's much thinner and it's also much lower profile. This stuff will fit into some really, really tight places. It's a little different than LED tape because in order to connect wires to this, you actually have to solder the wires to the back side of the tape. That's where the contact terminals are, and it's so tiny that you have to use visual aid to be able to see, to be able to solder on it. So put on your magnifying glasses or goggles or whatever you have, and get it down on the bench. What I did is I flipped them over and I taped them down so that nothing but the tip was sticking out here. And then I just went in really carefully with my hobby knife and scraped off. There's kind of a varnish that's on that's covering up the copper terminals. You just scrape that stuff off of there, and then you come in with your solder iron and dab on a really tiny little small drop of solder on each side. And then you can pre-tin a little wire. I'm using this, I always use this really fine 30 gauge wire for my models. I used to use the magnetic wire a long time ago, but I switched to this stuff a couple of years ago because it's got the vinyl coating on it, and it's much more flexible, and it doesn't seem to grab and turn into a bunch of spider web nest. And it's still really, really tiny diameter. So, basically strip this, tin it a little bit with your solder, and you can come down on there, and it will connect on there just absolutely perfect. It's not too big of wire where you're going to blob it, or, you know, have it worry about them touching each other because they're so close together. You just have to be careful when you dab the solder on there not to make a big, you know, blob of it. So you get your wires on there. It's got pre-resistored, so it's made to run from 9 to 12 volts. And it's already ready to go, and it lights up in white. Now, the thing that was nice is that gave me the clearance that I needed, right? But this is meant to be cut in certain segments, exactly like the LED tape. Those of you who have worked with it will know what I mean. There's a certain spot you can cut that tape. They're marked. If you cut in the wrong spot, part of the LED segment will no longer work because you've cut the circuit. But these have the same principle, but you can see that when I wound up using just two segments here, the length of them turned out to be exactly right for the length of my shuttle bay, so that I would have full lighting all the way from front to rear. I'll just kind of put the roof here so you can see it. All the way down this row and all the way down that row. I went with double row here in the center and then a single on each outer to light those little overhead lights, and that worked out absolutely perfect for that. So for the floor, I talked about this backlit Klingon logo that we have in here. I guess you shouldn't call it a logo, it makes them sound like a corporation. Their symbol, I wanted to backlight that. So when I test fit putting the shuttle bay in here, I looked to see where like the spot would be underneath of it that would have that light centered on the middle of this, and it turned out to be right there. And so I wound up using two little strips of regular LED tape because I had more room underneath here. I had almost a little over a quarter of an inch, almost a half inch actually. So I didn't have to worry about, you know, the clearance there. And here I used warm white LEDs. Now let me explain something that I found out quite a while ago about lighting. And that is, whenever you're gonna use this technique where you're going to use these Tamiya or any other kind of brand, these transparent colored paints, and you're going to just use regular white lighting to backlight that, use warm white lighting instead of regular white. And the reason why is it will keep the rich and bright colors It'll make them look more rich and bright, is what I'm trying to say. The regular white tends to wash them out and make them look kind of bleached or whatever, and it just doesn't look as good. I just figured that out after testing, you know, building all these models here. So I used warm white LEDs here, and I've got it sitting to where, you know, it's lighting up everything now. I've got it all wired together, and it lights the top and the bottom. I also went ahead and opened up these windows here above the shuttle bay. Those are going to be lit in red, kind of going with the theme of, you know, the red bridge lighting and the red observation deck lighting that I did on the neck, because the ship is in the middle of the scene where they're under emergency, you know, they're getting attacked by V'ger or whatever. So I decided to do those in red. And then we have our two little lights right here. Those are just two little 0805 SMDs in white, put on right in those little spots. Before I close all this up, I'll just come right here with a little dab of black paint and paint over those. That way, you know, the light still comes out just fine out the front, but back here will eliminate any of the light that might leak into my shuttle bay or, you know, around the edges or anything like that. So we're getting that set up. I've also put a single little red 0805 SMD right here, laying on its side, casting this way. And what that does is it lights up. There's a kind of an opening back here. You'll see it when we light it. There's a hatchway or something right here that's got some red. It looks like it could be another leading off to another corridor or something back there. So a little bit of shadowed red coming into that looks really, really cool. So we got that all ready to go. So I put it all in there and I started testing it out. And what I found was that it looked pretty good. I got plenty of light in there. But what was happening was my floor Klingon symbol was kind of getting washed out because the light coming from the ceiling was almost too strong. And so we know we're running this whole model at 12 volts. And so, you know, in theory, when we do that, all the light's going to be equal. Well, there's a little workaround you can do for kind of solving those little problems. And that is that you can use a resistor to slightly dim your lights in certain areas when you want full power going somewhere else, but you want a little bit less power going to something, without going into all the complicated using, you know, boards or voltage control regulators or any of that kind of stuff. This is really simple. And I have a whole huge box of resistors that I bought a couple years ago off of Radio Shack. And I think it came with 5,000 resistors, believe it or not, for like $5. And they were all over the place as far as values go, you know, like more or less resistance. And originally it came in a box and they were all nice and organized, but over time of me digging through it and using them, I've kind of got them all mixed up. I do have a little chart up on my wall here that shows me what these little values are on each one. And if I want to take my time, I can sit down here and hold them up and read the bands and figure out what they are. But when I'm just kind of, you know, having fun and in a hurry, and, well, not really in a hurry, but just don't want to go through all that technical stuff, I just kind of grab a handful of these things and lay them out like this and start testing them. So I wanted to make my lights on the ceiling up here dimmer than what they are down here. In other words, I want full power here, but I want a little bit less here, because I want to kind of balance out my lighting a little bit. I want this floor light to come through a little bit stronger to help light this floor up a little bit better. So I would just sit here with my power supply at 12 volts, and I would pick up one of these resistors and put it on here and look at it. And when I saw it got a little bit dimmer, I kind of put it in a pile like, okay, that's a potential, that might be one I want. And I just did a process of elimination and went all the way through them. Sometimes you'd notice that either it wouldn't light at all, which meant the resistance value of the resistor was way too high and wasn't letting enough current go through to even light the lights, or sometimes it wouldn't change the brightness at all, and that meant that it was a lower resistor than what was already on these LED strips, and it won't affect it when you do that. So, because doubling up resistors doesn't change anything, it'll only resist to the highest level of resistor and that's it, and it won't change it. So, process of elimination, I got down to where I had like four or five candidates here, and then I narrowed those down to the single one, and I got it just right. So I got a little resistor on here now, to where the power that's coming in, you can see exactly how I wired it here. The power that's coming in to the floor lights comes into the bottom side, so it comes straight through to the power. The power that's coming in to these lights here, it's got this resistor in line. So now we're splitting the power, and this one's getting less than we have in the floor. So problem solved. Like I said, a little trial and error going back and forth, and I was able to get that fine-tuned. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to mock this all together really quick, and I'll give you a look at this in low light, and I'll show you what we finally came up with. This looks really cool in person, and I think after you see it when you're getting ready to build your Katinga, many of you might want to go ahead and order that shuttle bay upgrade as well. So I'll be right back with that, everybody. All right, back to wrap everything up for one last look here at the shuttle bay all lit up, guys. I'll try to get you in close here and see if you can see the detail in there. Here's the walls. Again, we're missing that one decal, so don't pay any attention there. And you got the far back wall with that little kind of red glow coming out of it with the red SMD back there. And then this other wall over here. And you can see the really beautiful Klingon logo there on the floor, or the emblem, I should say. And here's the detail on the ceiling. I really love that effect with those strip lights running down like that. That looks really realistic. And our little overhead lights there for the, I guess that would be the shuttlecraft crew members up there in those control rooms or whatever. And we got the rear marker lights. I've got those resistored down too, because I figured you wouldn't want to have really bright lights blinding your shuttle bay pilots when they were trying to fly inside the shuttle bay. So we've got a couple more lights that need to go in on this upper part here. We've got a couple more small ones, one that goes up on these little manifold pieces, and then we've got the forward part to light the red glow coming out of the impulse grill intake. And then we've got the little wing lights here that I mentioned. We're going to use those lighthouse lights again to do the floodlight effect here on both wings. So, but all in all, it's looking really good, guys. Like I said, if you have any questions about any of this, you can always drop a comment here on the video, and hopefully I can answer it for you. And if there's anything that you want to see specific to what we're going to be working on in the future on this model, you can ask a question ahead of time there, like say, can you show that in the next video, and I'll try to get that in there for you. We're to the point now where we're going to be putting together the whole body part of this thing, but before I do that, I'm going to do all my painting on the surface here. I've got to do all these feathers and everything. I'm going to use masking and airbrush for that. We'll just see how far we can go. There's some of these that are really tiny and intricate. I may wind up in the end, if I run into troubled waters trying to mask it, I'll probably just go ahead and spring for a masking set, but we'll just see how it goes. I'll go as far as I can until I run into that and just see what happens. But we got to do a lot of assembly yet, and putting on the engines and putting on all these small little detail parts. But if there's something specific you guys want me to highlight in the next video, I'll be happy to do that for you. So there you go. There's the shuttle bay, everybody. Hopefully it shows up there good for you. Beautiful little addition, and I think it's well worth adding on to this kit, especially since it's not really even that expensive, and it's very easy to do the mod to make it work. So that's a wrap, everybody. We'll see you next time, and until we do, take care, and happy modeling, everyone.